Hi there. Welcome to Discussing Fitchburg Now. Our show here is going to be on the author's show. We're going to have Charley Valera on. We're going to have Sean Sweeney and Mark Bodanza talking about all the books that they've written. And Charley, written your inaugural book.
Yes.
Yes. So I have Charley Valera here now, the author of My Father's War.
Right.
Thanks for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah.
I'm liking this picture back here.
Yeah, we got the slideshow.
Sure.
Yeah.
And I'd be happy to go over any of their stories on any of those guys. That was a lot of fun.
Absolutely. So Charley just had a book launch party, right?
Yep.
This past Sunday.
Yep.
And you had, and how many vets that were in the book were there?
There was 11 that showed up that were in the book, which was amazing because I was surprised. I didn't know how many would show up. I started making phone calls just to remind them. I sent them all formal invitations, you know.
Yeah.
But you never know because they're not local. Some of the guys are from the Worcester area or on the outside, Oxford. And it's a little bit of a deal, you know. They're in their mid-90s. And so have 11 of them show up was the coolest thing. And as you saw, they just sat in line and everybody was signing books. They were having a blast. Yeah. There was several hundred people, probably 300 or 400 that came through that day.
So your book, My Father's War, is like a collection of individual stories from World War II vets that you've interviewed.
Yep.
Over the course of how many years?
Took me about 2.5 years, just over 2 years to do all the interviews and to write it up.
Mm-hmm.
Originally, I was just going to do one person at a time. You know, sit with them.
Like one entire book dedicated to one story?
No, I was going to do one veteran, go home and write it up. What I do is I videoed him, much like you and I sitting here. Mm. And I'd set up a video camera. And so that way there, I got the story straight. And I didn't just sit there and try to remember what they said. I wanted exactly the way they remembered it. It doesn't have to be exactly the way it happened.
Yep.
It has to be exactly the way they remembered it. So when you hear about maybe being in the aircraft and the thing is on fire or being in a foxhole for weeks, I wanted to bring what they had to say onto the pages so as a reader we could sit there with them. Because that's how I felt when I was talking
with
them. I was enthralled
literally
with it. Yeah, yeah. And it was tough because I wanted to just like joke with them and stuff and go, wow, you know, how'd you do that? But you can't do too much because you're trying to video it, you know.
Yeah. And you want to hear exactly their story. You don't want to kind of interject other thoughts.
Right.
You want to get exactly what they're thinking.
And that would have been easy just to have a conversation, you and I sitting around, right?
Right.
But, yeah, we'd be interrupting each other, right? But you can't do that when you're trying to interview somebody. I really wanted their stories. And they've been keeping them to themselves for years. So it was, I think it was very therapeutic for them as well.
Oh, yeah.
To share, and also the photographs.
Mm.
Now, every time I went back to these guys are funny.
They found more photographs?
Oh, yeah, yeah. You go back, and there's another envelope there, and it's like loaded with pictures. Not everybody, but a lot of the guys had a lot of photos. Some of the guys were photographers. They had cameras. There was two that I can think of that had their own cameras. That's off the top of my head. But yeah, you'd go there and they'd have all these pictures. And
yeah, there are a lot of great pictures in here. Especially specifically of the men in the book.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I put 137 photos in there.
137?
Yep. And I think the publishers wanted 50.
Aha.
So that's why, you know, I didn't want to go with the traditional publishing. This was too important to the families and to the veterans to give control over just a regular publishing company, and they would have said, well, we're going to use these dozen photos.
Yeah, I got, like, in the honorable mention section,
yep.
I got Erwin Markowitz.
Erwin, amazing, amazing
he signed his
guy.
Photo right there.
Yeah, it was great to see him show up the other day. I was so happy because he came from the other side of Worcester. And like most of these guys, he can't hear well, so I'd walk in and I'd start yelling, hey, Erwin, it's me. Because I've probably had to go back to everybody's house 3, 4, 5 times. You know, this wasn't a one-shot deal.
Right.
You have to go back and
keep opening up, and they keep remembering.
Yeah, and I have questions. You know, were you in France, or were you in England during this period of time? And you know what I mean? Because
so you'd go, you'd take their story, you'd write it down, but then you maybe cross-reference with facts and figures from history and try to match up exactly where they were?
Right, yeah.
That seems like what you did with your father's accountants.
That's exactly what I did, yeah. But, of course, he wasn't here to confuse me. with him, I took his discharge papers, which I didn't even know how to read them. I actually took it to Air Venture at Oshkosh. You know what that is, the big aviation event. And I took the discharge papers, I'd just gotten them, and I showed them to a Tuskegee Airman.
Uh-huh.
And I said, can you read this? Because I don't know what it means. And he looked at it and he said, whoever this guy is, you know, you really should thank him. He's been in 11 campaigns. So he explained it to me, and I just went back and figured out where he would have been. But with these guys, it was a little different because they would tell me, but nobody talks in chronological order.
Right.
So
you're talking stories.
Right.
That they remember.
Right. And then you got to kind of figure it out. It was fun. And, you know, we're like family, all of us. All of them. They were so cool.
Yeah, during the book launch party, that was amazing.
It was.
There was a huge crowd. Did you estimate how many people came?
Probably around 400.
400 people to the Leominster Veterans Center.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a great. And I see that you're going to do one again, you're thinking about?
Well, I know I'm going to do a book signing at Barnes & Noble.
Yeah.
Because that's scheduled for
with
June.
With all the vets?
I'll get as many there as want to show up. That's in June. That's actually scheduled already for the day before Father's Day.
The day before Father's Day.
Yeah, that's a Sunday, of course, so I'll be there on Saturday afternoon.
Fantastic. Your chance to get your book signed.
That's right. Mm. And if you're lucky, you'll get some of the veterans to sign it. So I see yours has been signed by
quite a few people. I got it signed by every vet at the book launch.
Unbelievable.
Me and Stan the man hung out for an hour in the line.
That's awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Charlie Sanderson. Great guys. These guys, it just amazes me the stories that they had and how they overcome. I don't know how you actually can overcome that type of adversity and then come home as if it was, I don't know, you put it behind you after, you know, 3 years being away and never knowing if you're ever going to come back again.
One story, he was a pilot and there was a fire in the engine.
Yeah.
And he knew to, I don't know, fly down and so that the flames didn't hit the gas tank. And he flew down like 10,000 feet until the flames went out.
20,000.
And they all survived 20,000 feet.
Yeah.
They all survived.
And he slipped it down to 20.
Slip side?
It's a slip. It's called a slip. It's an unconventional maneuver. And the trick to that is if you put the nose down too much, you're going to exceed the maximum structural capacity of the aircraft. So you're going to rip the wings off.
Oh, yeah.
You don't want to do that. No, that's a bad thing. But you can't
go
too...
you've got to go forward and to the side.
Right. Down to the side, but not too much. So you control it with the nose. And but you got to get that fire out. You know, it's up on the wing and everybody's looking up at it. It's like, it's got to be horror. It has to be horror.
And you say in the book that he didn't seem to be too... You know, like me and you were like, oh, my God.
I know. We talk about it. We get all fired up.
But he's like, oh, that happened a few times.
Yeah. Unbelievable, huh?
Yeah.
Those guys are just amazing people.
I love in this book how they're individual accountings. So every book, every chapter is a new book.
Well, you know, I don't have the attention span sometimes to sit and read a whole book. I do, but it takes me a long time. So I wrote it the way I like to read it, and I think other people might enjoy, so that each person gets their own, like you said, their own section. I called it a book because they're all so individual. And that whole section might be on one guy and, you know, and over here. So it's easy enough to just go through it and enjoy it and not have to feel like, oh, I got to read this 300-page book.
It is broken up perfectly. And each individual book is broken up into perfect little chapters.
Isn't it neat? Nice and easy reading.
And the interspersing of pictures makes it interesting. Yeah. It's a great book.
There's still like 12 hours worth of reading in there, I think. Mm-hmm. At least that's what they say.
And is there an audio version?
Not yet.
But there is going to be.
I don't know yet. I'm looking into it.
Uh-huh.
I am definitely looking into it. It can be expensive because it
takes someone to dictate.
Yeah. Why, do you do that on the side?
I don't.
Not yet.
But that sounds like fun.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know how
I know Sean Sweeney, our next guest, I know he has his books dictated.
All right.
And
you can buy those
on audiobook.
Well, good. You can have Mark come in next, and I'll talk to Sean.
Yeah, he knows all about it.
Right.
So what are the next events for your book? Because, I mean, it seems like it's gotten
such a
great response. Mm.
Yeah, it's been overwhelming. It's been just fantastic. What's next? I don't even know. I have a calendar that
Barnes & Noble sold out of your book.
Yeah, but they have some, again.
Yeah.
So they do have some.
But that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm going to reach out to,
the,
you know, I was just on the NECN, and so I want to get shooting into that market a little bit more because the gentleman that I spoke to actually when I was there, did you get to meet Mike Nikitas?
I don't know.
NECN, no. He, when I was at NECN, he came over, he's the anchor man, and he came over to talk to my wife, and he gave her his father's story.
Uh-huh.
That he wrote about his father being
A book.
No, he just wrote a story.
A story.
And it was in the Boston Globe about his father being one of the last POWs of the war.
Mm.
And it was pretty brutal. And then he left it for her and he said, have your husband call me. So I did. And that's why he was there the other day. He showed up Sunday with his mom.
Yeah.
And bought a couple copies. So anyhow, I'm looking to see about getting into that market a little bit more because there seems to be such a big demand for these type of stories that are real and they're easy enough to read and they're firsthand. You know, I didn't want to put it into a long story.
It's put together nicely and the format is down. You think that you're going to have a sequel?
It's very possible, yeah.
Because there are more stories to be told, right?
There is, but, you know, I'm running out of subjects. I mean, it's difficult. I have to find more guys, and this was not easy. This was very difficult. And then when they started pouring in, because for sure, maybe about a month period of time, I did get a lot as a result of the local Sentinel doing a story.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, that helped so much. Oh, there was such
a big locate help. More...
Veterans.
World War II veterans.
Yeah.
That might be interested in telling their story.
Right. And so what they do is they showed up at the flight school saying, hey, we understand you're looking for a veteran. I was in the war. Or guys would call me and say, my dad was in the war. Do you want to talk with him? And so at that point, I started doing 2-3 interviews a day.
Mm.
And it was getting really busy. And, you know, everything's time stamped. So my pictures, my videos, and I knew what belonged to whom. But I still had to go back and check my appointment book and say, now, where was I at 2 o'clock?
It's still,
4 o'clock.
You might be organized, but you still got to put it all together. It's
you
a
do.
Lot of hours.
Yeah. Yeah. But it was a blast.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they're very well. There probably will be some sort of part 2, but I'm not sure yet. I'm just having fun with this.
Yeah. I checked my ancestry just mm-hmm. after seeing this. I'm like, oh, I think my mm-hmm. grandfather Good. Was in World War II, and he was.
Yep.
He enlisted in 1943,
mm-hmm.
World War II,
mm-hmm.
As an Army private.
Okay.
There's a picture. I got a picture of him in some green wool-looking suit,
mm-hmm.
the hat.
Those were the guys I wanted to talk to. I didn't want to talk to the generals and the West Point guys. No offense to them, but that stuff's already been documented.
Mm.
I wanted to talk to the guys that were in the foxholes, the truck drivers, the pilots. I wanted to talk to the guys that... the spokes that made it happen, guys like your grandfather. And if you want, we can talk later about how you can find out where your grandfather was. Because there are companies that do the research.
Oh,
very,
that'd be interesting.
Very inexpensive.
Because I have some paperwork,
you
know, from Ancestry.com through, like, discharge papers.
That's all
the registration paper.
Mm-hmm.
I think he was drafted.
Probably.
In 1943. I think it was the draft.
Yep.
So there's the draft card and...
Aren't you curious about where how long he was in? Well, you know when he went in and came out.
You know, I never was before.
Right.
But now all of a sudden.
Yeah, the guy was a hero.
Yeah, I'm like, what about
he did
my?
It.
Like, I'm like, oh, I wonder if my grandfather did this stuff.
I'm sure he did, and you know, I'm hoping that you can find somebody in here that is very close to what your grandfather did.
You like an Army private.
Right. Well, there's privates in here. There's a lot of them.
Yeah.
And lieutenants and sergeants. You know, I have one captain. But I didn't want, again, I wanted those guys. I wanted the guys that made it happen.
Well, you get the full range of story. Like you said,
everyone
does a story on the majors.
Yeah.
And,
right.
Yeah.
And you know, those have already been documented.
Hmm.
But I also tried to get from various, you know, Navy as well as... Marines, Air Force, different, you know, in the other theaters as well. And it was a little tricky to get, for some reason or another, from the Pacific Theater. It wasn't very easy. So I did locate a few guys, and they're in there. But hopefully you and anybody else will be able to look at or read something in here and say, geez, I think my father did the same thing during the war, or my grandfather.
Yeah.
I think he was also a gunner, or he was a... He was in an aircraft of some sort, a B-17.
It's inspiring people to learn more about their own family's history.
I hope so.
Or
that would be
friends
fantastic.
Friends and neighbors.
Yeah. Oh, that would be so cool.
Yeah.
That would be, that's just be the icing of the cake, because we do need to know who they are.
Yeah. And, I mean, once they're gone, their stories die with them.
Well, you know, that was kind of how we got here. You know, my father died and took his stories with him. We never got to hear any of them.
Right. But you created that.
I did.
You recreated that.
I just wanted to make sure that this story's continued, because it is important. And, you know, you and I can kind of take it now for granted and not give it a second thought. But that war could have gone in any direction. That was not a given. When your grandfather was forced, I was going to say, but he was. When he was drafted,
yep.
There was no outcome that was going to be decided yet. There was no, well, we got this wrapped up. It wasn't
right.
Like it was, you know, Larry Bird, and we got 5 minutes left in the game. We're down by five.
Was,
we're going to win it.
What, Japan attacked us.
We had a lot of problems.
Yeah.
The Japanese war alone
we had a lot of problems.
Was a whole separate war. And then you had the European theater. Mm. And so we had two fronts we were fighting on. I mean, we were allies with the Russians. It was just...
So now I'm like, where did my grandfather go? Yeah, this guy. Charlie Rogers.
The
grasshopper pilot.
Yeah, amazing.
I was talking to Dan Cunningham from the Rotary.
Okay.
And I was like, hey, you want to see my book?
Look at it.
And he's like, oh, grasshopper pilot.
Yep.
I said, you know what that is? And he said, it's a small helicopter.
No.
Was that right?
No, it's a Piper Cub.
Oh, it's a Piper.
He was flying. You know what a Piper Cub is? A little two-seater.
Okay.
Right? They got like a 75-horse engine.
Yep.
And he just barely went over the treetops, and his job with a spotter was to fly to find the enemy, which was easy enough because they were shooting at him, find out where they were, and the guy in the back would write it down on a chart wherever they could find the enemy, then fly back. So you could only go an hour or so each way because you didn't have enough fuel.
Mm-hmm.
And then you came back, you let your officers know, here's where we found them.
It was recon.
It was all recon. But you couldn't fly the same way out or the same way back.
Because they're shooting at you.
Yeah, they're shooting at you nonstop. So you're kind of zigzagging and you're doing one of these and you're close to
like
the treetops.
Like a grasshopper.
And you're
next to the treetops for cover.
For cover and to kind of go under the radar, because they're not going to bomb the treetops. They're shooting over the trees to get the Allies on the other side. The other interesting thing with that was that they didn't have any radio communications. So when they came back, they'd come back to an empty field at times. Everyone would bug out and they'd move. And they'd come back and say, where is everybody? You know, everyone's gone. So they'd have to remember or try to remember where they may have been moved to next and then go there and find a spot to land. Totally amazing that these guys could do that.
Hmm.
And it's not like they had a GPS, you know, their iPad hit direct too.
Right.
You know, like we fly with...
And reading these stories, the wars that were fought back then are never going to be fought again.
No.
War that we fight today is a completely different war.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing, you know.
These were brutal massacres. Mm. And the things that these guys saw and took home with them, and then just somehow or another tried, and they've tried for 70 years. Some of these guys still get very choked up, very, very emotional. I know one guy that was diagnosed with PTSD at 91 years old. Fine time to give him help, huh? You know, it had to have been emotionally draining. There was another guy, he's in there, he was married for 4 weeks. 4 weeks you get married. Sent over to England. On his six-month wedding anniversary, he was already a POW for 3 months. So he got over there. He was only there for 3 months. He got shot down. He was taken on as a POW.
And how long was he?
About a year as a POW.
Oof.
Right.
Yeah.
Horrible. Actually, you know, we ended up with Stalag 3, which is where they made the movie The Great Escape from. He got there about 2 months after that actually happened. And what they were doing afterwards was they were actually taking the captured escapees, there was about 77 of them, they were taking them back to that Stalag, and they would take them out and shoot them one at a time in front of everybody, just to set an example. I'm sure Tom was there during that. He had to have seen some of that. He had to have witnessed it, because they made sure everybody saw everything. And that was the whole point in it. And having 76 or 77 escapees that they captured. They just dragged it out. They wanted to make sure that everybody knew, don't try this again, because here's your buddies. And they just take them out and shoot them in front of everyone. Isn't that brutal?
That's inconceivable to me.
Isn't it, though? It is. It's way inconceivable. It's like a black and white clip to you and I. So that's why I did all this. That's part of it.
Well, thank you for doing it. All right. So, Charley Valera, My Father's War. Thank you for coming on and telling us about it. And you can find out more information at charleyvalera.com.
Yep, charleyvalera.com.
Charleyvalera.com. And you have a Facebook page, My Father's War.
Book.
Memories from our honored World War II soldiers.
That's correct. Yeah. It's also available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, iTunes. If you go to charleyvalera.com, it does come to me and I can personalize it.
I hope.
Make it out to whomever you want it made out to.
You can get it personally signed by Charley. All right, thanks for coming on.
And I make them out to the people.
You know. All right. So we're going to take a short break, and up next we're going to talk to Sean Sweeney. Hi there. Sam Squally here with Donald Flagg and Tara Rivera talking about Crossing Over Cerber House's Resource Fair and Comedy Night. Donald, I got something for you.
What's up?
Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Interrupting cow.
Interrupting cow.
Moo! Is the comedy night going to be that good?
I think so, yes. We can match that, yes, absolutely. We can definitely match that, absolutely. What do you think?
I think so.
Yeah.
So the comedy night is going to be Saturday, May 27th at the Leominster High School. And tell us a little bit about it.
Go ahead, Tara.
All right. So May 27th, we're going to have a resource fair from 6 to 7 p.m. And when I say resource fair, what I mean is we're going to have vendors from the local community who can offer services to folks who are maybe suffering from substance use disorder or have a loved one who are suffering from substance use disorder, available to talk with the public, let them know what services they have to offer. And that way we can get a little education in before we get our comedy on.
Yeah.
So Recovery Resources America and those kinds of vendors are going to be there to talk.
Absolutely, yep. So treatment centers, we'll have some the therapists available. We'll have some Learn to Cope probably will be there as well. So we're going to have a lot of vendors basically who can support folks in recovery as well as loved ones who have people who have loved ones who are suffering from the disease of addiction.
So more information about recovery and, and the different stages and how to cope.
Yeah, it's really important with all the events that we try to do. We always want to provide an opportunity for education. We think it's really important for people to get those resources out there. And we're super excited about the event.
Yeah, and then to brighten up the mood, we're going to have a comedy night.
Yeah.
So the comedy show starts at 7 o'clock?
Yeah, around 7 o'clock, the starting should be going off at that point, and we're really excited about that. And so that's where we came up with the name, Laughing for Recovery.
Laughing for Recovery,
Laughing
that's good.
For Recovery, yeah. All the proceeds will go to creating scholarships for men that want to continue their journey in recovery. Also to help us get a van, which is an instrumental tool in that.
Yeah.
And, recovery's real. And we all are faced every day with the shadows of addiction and what's going on out there. But what we don't hear is the success stories. Mm. And what we don't see is the people who do succeed and continue to go on with their lives because they become members of society. And so we just want to encourage that while people are seeing the epidemic that's going on out there, we just want to encourage people that there is a solution to the problem and that people all in the community are pulling together, especially from the mayor to the chief of police. They're all pulling together in a community of an effort. So we just want to kind of pull together the people, celebrate that recovery is real, and give them an opportunity to have a good night out.
All right. That sounds great. So this is a comedy night to benefit the Crossing Over Sober House,
which
is in Fitchburg.
That's right.
Tickets are
$20. That's right.
And the show is Saturday, May 27th. 6 to 7 p.m. Come for the resource fair. 7 p.m. and on. Stay for the comedy show.
Hope to see you there.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Sam. Appreciate it.
Welcome back to Discussing Fitchburg Now, our author's show. Now I have Sean Sweeney here with me. Hi, Sean.
Hi, Sam. How are you?
I'm great.
Good to see you, as always.
You too. Thanks for
coming
on.
Love your boots.
Oh, yeah? You like that?
Didn't the last time I was here...
I think you said that. I think you opened with that exact same thing.
About your shoes.
Yeah.
Now, that's a tip to all the guys that are watching. Comment a lady about her shoes.
Oh, yeah?
Yes. Mm. Yes. Always thinking. Always thinking.
So, how many words did you write today?
I wrote 2341, but not in fiction. I had some sports writing stuff I had to do today, which, you know, took a little bit of precedence. So
you count the amount of words that you write for sports stuff, too?
I do, because I kind of want to see, you know, how much time I'm wasting.
You call that wasting time?
It is. My wife doesn't think so, but, you know, it is what it is.
Yeah. Yeah. Because, frankly, the sports writing is one of my favorite.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, brilliant. Oh, the Longs Joe write-ups that
are
absolutely brilliant.
I try. You know, it's one of a kind thing. So, you know, you get that opportunity to, you know, use the writing muscles that I use for the fiction into the sports, because with the high school, you know, it's very, you know, it's kind of vanilla.
Vanilla.
You know, so to speak.
You know, kind of the same thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Repeating. Yeah. In different names and different places.
Yeah. Yeah. And
different scores.
It's something different to do, so.
Yeah.
I love the long show.
You're like a Renaissance man writer, right? I mean, you write everything. Right? That's one thing that I noticed about you, right? You do sports and all sorts of nonfiction.
Yeah.
And then you do all kinds of, and then you do the fiction.
Yeah.
But you do all kinds of different genres.
Like some
authors, you know them as a comedy.
Yeah.
Or you know them as a...
Like Stephen King. You know
Stephen
you're going to get your pants scared off you.
Yeah.
You know, Michael
like
Connelly
an intellectual
is going to have...
Thriller.
Yeah, Michael Connelly will have like the police procedurals and, you know, Vince Flynn, God rest his soul, you know, did the conservative-sided... political thrillers like Brad Thor and David Baldacci, and obviously J.K. Rowling. We all know what J.K. Rowling does.
Yep.
So, I mean, it's, you know...
They kind of get into their niche, but you have many different categories.
I have a lot of different interests. Like, when I started way back when, in 2003, I was a fantasy author.
Mm-hmm.
And I did that for quite a few years. And
is that when you were John Fitch 5?
John Fitch the 5th.
So just the fifth,
and that was in honor of Mr. Cormier, Robert Cormier from Leominster,
mm-hmm.
way back when. And I stopped doing the John Fitch the Fifth pen name in 2010, and I started being myself again in 2011 when Model Agent came out way back when.
Mm-hmm. SS, those are great initials.
I know.
They're my favorite.
Seriously? Really, Sam?
So your newest book,
yeah.
Ticket Agent.
Yes.
Which is, what is it, eighth in the series?
That's the eighth in the series, correct.
Eighth in the series of the Jacqueline Johnson.
Yes.
Yes.
Uh-huh. Yes.
And what's interesting about this is it's only in the span of like a week?
About that, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. You want it to be fast-paced, so you are, you know, drawing the reader in. I like to call it grabbing the reader by the throat.
By the throat.
And dragging them into the story.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's I try to keep it as fast-paced as possible. When I was writing Rogue Agent, I had started, before even writing the book, I was watching episodes of 24.
Aha. Because the whole thing is one day.
Yeah, in order to get the pacing down, make sure it's fast and you know, keep the reader interested. You want to keep the reader flipping pages.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have them on tenterhooks all the way through, they're going to keep flipping pages and just trying to see what happens next.
Yeah, because everything's like times. It's like time and time stamped and location stamped.
Yes.
Yeah, like, you know, it all goes from like... It's span of a week.
Yeah,
from
about
a Wednesday
that.
To a Monday.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's weird because, you know, this is all... This book is taking place on two continents. You know, it starts out in South Dakota,
mm-hmm.
moves to...
London?
No, first it goes into southern New York. I'm not going to tell the locale.
Mm.
Keep them, make you flip the pages a little bit. And then it'll shift to London and D.C. So it goes back and forth like that.
So she's a special agent.
She is a counterterrorism agent.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And what's the Cliff's notes?
She's a partially blind CIA counterterrorism agent who was, as I call it in the narrative, born from the ashes of terrorism itself. Her parents were killed in 9/11 at the Pentagon in the fictional universe. And she was obviously an orphan. She was about 14 years old at that time. And the director of the CIA, the fictional director of the CIA, flies to Seattle, gets her, convinces her to come and fight terrorism, teaches her, nurtures her, and turns her into, a badass, mm-hmm. So she uses a cover of being a fashion model. And
the blonde bombshell?
The blonde bombshell, yeah. Mm-hmm. And she uses that, the funds from that, to fund her exploits going overseas and all that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that's my main series, and I'm writing number 9 right now.
Yep. This seems to be the most popular one.
Oh, without a doubt.
Yeah.
Without a doubt.
And number 9 is, when is number 9 coming out? Scouring Agent.
Next February.
Next, we have to wait a whole...
You have to. I'm only 30,000 words into this new one.
You know, one great thing about following Sean on Facebook is he tells you every day how many words he wrote.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I have to. I have to keep the readers...
I'm interested. I'm like, oh, how many words? Oh, that sounds like a lot of words. But then again, I don't really know.
Yeah, well, You think about 1,000 words, depending on how you structure your paragraphs and your chapters.
Mm-hmm.
1,000 words can be anywhere from 2 to 3.5 pages.
Okay.
So, I mean, depending on how, your speed and, like I said, how you set up
the page.
Your set up
how
the page.
How much white space you have.
Right, and how much dialogue you have. And because sometimes
so you really
dialogue,
can't go by pages. So that's why you got to go by words.
Yeah, dialogue can be very short, concise sentences, or can be very long, flowy narratives. Like Robert B. Parker, the late Robert B. Parker, was very good at the concise dialogue in his prose.
Short conversations?
Very, very short, like quick hit, like ba-ba-ba, ba-ba-ba, ba-ba-ba. Yeah.
So the book you wrote right before Ticket Agent was a whole new type of series.
Yeah, I was asked.
Like a piratey kind of sailing the seas.
I was asked by a friend of mine who actually does the agent covers. He's also an author. He had this idea of an alternative universe set in the Caribbean Sea during the Golden Age of piracy. And I'm like, okay, yeah, that's pretty cool.
I love Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah, and that's basically loosely what I had to watch in order to get in the mindset. Yeah. And this series, or this book, is following the exploits of Paulina, who is a privateer.
And Privateer.
She's not exactly the best one because she's lost a couple of ships already going into the narrative of this book.
That sounds pretty bad.
Yeah, she's not that great. But she says it's not because of her skills. It's because of the men around her.
Mm-hmm.
So she says she has idiots. So, yes, all women. It's an all-female crew.
Yep.
And they do very well.
Mm-hmm.
And they sail for treasure, and they ram her old boyfriend's ship.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's hilarious.
I love this concept because I remember when I was little, I read books about sailing.
Yeah.
Old ships. And they were just fascinating to me. So I had to buy this right when it came out.
Yeah, that was a while ago.
Yeah, it was a few months.
Yeah, December.
Yeah.
I wanted that book to come out in like October.
Yeah, for the Christmas. For Christmas sales.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
For the pre holiday rush, because once you get in December, it's like, everyone's already spending their money.
It's not as easy as writing a book.
Oh, I know.
There's so much more involved.
Oh
right?
My God, there's so much.
You can't just write the book. You got to market the
book. There's marketing.
You got to plan the book. You got to do the cover. You got to.
Yes. And marketing, especially in my end. When I had started in like 2010, you can just flood Facebook with your links, like on the Amazon Kindle page or on the Nook page. and people would actually see it, and they would buy your book.
Yeah.
But now with the way that Facebook is set up,
now,
it's
like
kind of difficult.
5% of the people that like your page will see your posts.
Right, exactly. So so my organic reach is down, and it's, you know, how do we get
the
my audience back? Yeah. What I'm planning on doing is this summer, I'm going to give away The Long Crimson Line, which is a book that I wrote about 3 years ago, and it's probably the most envelope-pushing book that I've ever written. And I'll give that away in a Mobi format or an EPUB format. Mobi for your Kindle, EPUB for a Nook or a Kobo or...
Because you're the vast majority of the audience reads things on the Kindle,
well,
right?
Well, you know, it is
what it is. I'm still old school.
I know you are. I mean, look at that.
I'm still old school.
But, you know, you give away a free book as an enticement to sign up for your mailing list. And if they like it, they're going to go on to buy more books. So when the next book that I'm going to be releasing, which is the follow-up to The Long Crimson Line, more than likely being optimistic in November,
they'll want to read
the next book, and they'll buy it on the first day. The prevailing theory is that if you have 2,000 people on your mailing list, on release day, 150 to 200 people of those are going to buy the book, and that's going to propel you into the Amazon top 100. And then Amazon's algorithms take over, and they will do the work for you.
Yeah, and then you show up higher in searches.
Right, right. So it's basically about, you know, buying some Facebook ads and saying, hey, you know, I'm a wannabe USA Today best-selling author. Here's the first book to start your library, and then, you know, you go from there.
If you like me, pay attention.
If you like me, there you go. And that's the weird thing about book selling today. But, you know, getting a mailing list down is kind of reason why, a lot of the authors today that are independently published, self-published, they wanted to do away with the middleman publishers, agents. And then now with Facebook kind of stepping in and killing your organic reach.
You need a new approach. You've got to constantly
and
be
this
evolving.
Is a way to, keep up with that, cutting out that middleman and going straight to the readers.
Yeah, directly to the audience.
Which is what we wanted to do anyway.
Yeah.
Go directly to the readers without the gatekeepers.
I follow you.
You follow me?
Follow you.
You follow me, Sam.
So anything in between now and February for releases?
Well, Persuaded by the Reflections, which is the follow-up to Long Crimson Line, we're hoping that's going to be out in November. That's an optimistic approach. I mean, that book took me a long time to write, and I finished it in February, so I'm giving it some time to... I'll be taking care of that in probably May or June, depending on when I finish scouring, the first draft of scouring. Then I'll take a couple days, decompress, and then I'll start on that first read-through and first edit of Persuaded, which is 135,000 words. It's going to take me a while.
So you finish the book, mm-hmm. and then you read it yourself?
Yes.
Ah. Yeah. Do you have anyone else read it before?
I have a few other people who will do it after me.
What do you call those people?
I call them beta readers or
proofreaders. Proofreader.
Yeah, editor. They catch the mistakes that I make, that I don't catch myself.
Or the things that don't make sense.
Right, yeah, because it might make sense to me, but it might not make sense to them, and they'll write a note, and then they'll send it back to me, and I'll think on it, and I'll change it if necessary.
So after you finish a book, it takes over 6 months
to
get it to print.
Definitely. I mean, I finished that book. I finished... Let's take Ticket, for example.
Ticket Agent?
Ticket, I started that in mid-March last year, maybe a little bit before, and I finished it at the end of June. And then it goes through, I give it a 3-month window for it to the story to escape my mind, and then I'll start editing after about 3 or 4 months.
So when you read it again, it's
remember,
you're
fresh.
Oh yeah, that's right.
It's very fresh in your mind. Now, I could probably start editing Persuaded right now. I could probably do half the book because I wrote that half from September until sometime in November. Mm-hmm. And that gives me, that part of the book is definitely out of my head by now. But I'll wait until late May, early June, end of June, before I finally sit down with the book in front of me, the manuscript, I should say.
Yep.
The first draft, and I'll read through it. And it'll take me about a week because it's a very beefy book. You know, you don't want to overdo it on one day. Mm-hmm. You know, so you'll give it, you know, 5 or 6 days, probably after the long show.
When all the hard work starts.
Oh, yeah. And it's fun. You know, the edit is fun. You know, you just have to, you know, set yourself into it. You get yourself out of the story, and then you read it as an editor. Mm-hmm. You know, you're using your other side of the mind.
Yep.
One side of the mind is your creative side.
The right side. You're using the right side.
And then the other side, you're using, you know, your editorial, your analytical side to break it down.
All right, great. Well, so where can we find out more information? Is it SeanSweeneyAuthor.com?
Yes, it is.
So you go to SeanSweeneyAuthor.com.
Yeah.
You can sign up for the mailing list. You can see all the different types of books that you've read.
Yeah,
you can get links
to buy
the Kindle version and the Amazon.
Most of the books are in ink and paper now.
Yep. Yeah. Okay, great.
Because
I know you're
like the only person in the world who cares about that. Now.
No battery, right? You're not going to worry about a battery or dropping it in the ocean. Well, actually, you do have to worry about that. Yeah. But you know what I mean.
Are you okay? How much coffee have you drank today? I'd like you to reduce that by half.
Okay, so you go to SeanSweeneyAuthor.com. You can follow on Facebook, SeanSweeney, Author.
Just SeanSweeneyAuthor.
SeanSweeneyAuthor.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And any other way that we can contact you?
On Twitter, at SMSweeneyAuthor.
At SMSweeneyAuthor.
SMSweeneyAuthor, yep.
Yeah, so follow Sean, and you'll get to learn all about what he's writing every day.
That's the book Twitter.
Yeah.
The sports writing Twitter is Mr. Sean M. Sweeney.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm all over the place.
Different hats.
It is what it is. Yeah, you start, you go from, you know, 8 a.m. until 1 p.m. as the author, and then after that, you put on the sports writing hat. It works.
Sounds good.
It works.
All right. Thanks, Sean, for coming on.
It's always a pleasure to see you, Sam. And I can't wait to come back in another 49 weeks.
Sounds good.
Awesome.
All right. So we're going to take a short break and on to our last author, Mark Bodanza. Hello. I'm here with Kelly Johnson from Growing Places. And we're talking about the herb spiral build at the community orchard.
So Growing Places has a community garden at the Sundial on Elm Street. Mm-hmm. And we also have a community orchard, which has 3 pear trees and 8 raspberry bushes. So we're expanding a little bit, and on Saturday, April 22nd, which is Earth Day, from 12 to 2, we're going to be building an herb spiral garden. So we're inviting the community, come on out, bring the kids, get your hands dirty,
celebrate. Learn how to build an herb spiral.
Yeah, and as well, while that's going on, we'll have other, you know, kids' activities. We're going to have some food. We're going to have live music. Mm. Really making a day out of it.
Sounds cool.
Very cool.
Yeah. So this is Saturday, April 22nd, Earth Day.
Earth Day.
From 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. And this is free and open to everybody.
We want as many people there as humanly possible. The more the better. And one other thing that we're going to be doing while we're building is we're going to be signing people up. Growing Places and New View Communities have partnered together to do a garden box competition within the city of Fitchburg this year. So if, Sam, you want a garden box in your front yard to beautify Fitchburg, enter your name. We're going to be starting registering people on the 22nd. We're registering until June 1st. Grow throughout the season this summer, and then we're going to have judging.
Take a picture, like the best looking box.
We're going to have a ton of different categories, and we're going to have judges go around end of August. So maybe you don't have a lot of room in your front yard, so you could do a planter out front. Mm. Maybe you have a lot of room and you want to enter multiple categories.
Garden box competition, I like it.
Right.
Now tell me, what is an herb spiral?
So,
is it this big?
Nope. Figures start it from the ground, and it's a buildup of bricks, and then as it builds up, you put different herbs all around. Cool. So it kind of waters itself.
That's the kind of herb spiral I need.
Yeah, so it's a lot of fun. Right. We're really looking forward to it. We need hands on deck to help us with this.
So you can go to growingplaces.org for more information?
We will be putting up more information. We're going to be making a Facebook page as well, so I'm sure you will be plugging it on DFN.
Sure.
So we love that. We're going to have an event page before long, and then the registration, yes, will be through Growing Places or New View Communities.
Great.
Yeah.
Thanks, Kelly. Okay, so that's Saturday, April 22nd, Earth Day, 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. We're going to do an herb spiral build.
Yes, at our current...
For Growing Places and New View Community.
Yeah.
At the Sundial.
Sundial Community Gardens.
Okay. Thanks,
Yay.
Kelly.
Thanks, guys.
Surviving member of that team.
Welcome back to Discussing Fitchburg Now. I'm on with my last guest, Mark Bodanza.
Good evening.
Welcome.
Well, thanks for having me.
Yeah, glad you're here. So, your latest book, we were just chatting about that, Rivals.
Correct.
Right? Which
yes.
is the third in your football series.
Yes, of the seven books I've written, three of them have to do with the Leominster-Fitchburg rivalry in some way. 1933 is a little different because it sort of talks about football in a broader sense.
Mm, not just the Leominster-Fitchburg rivalry.
1933 was a unique year in football locally and throughout the nation. In 1933, Leominster and Fitchburg, for the only time on Thanksgiving, met while both teams were undefeated. And they had quite the game. Fitchburg prevailed.
Fitchburg and Leominster both were undefeated.
Going into Thanksgiving, yeah. It's only happened once.
Wow. And Fitchburg won.
And Fitchburg won.
Wow.
Yeah. And they both had two great football players, Ronnie Cahill for Leominster and Bill Mackey for Fitchburg. And I had the honor of interviewing Mr. Mackey for that book for 1933. He was 96 years old.
Wow.
He was the sole surviving member of the Fitchburg High School football team at the time.
Wow.
Of that year. And I remember one of the interesting stories, he was called in 1995 by a Sentinel reporter who had just realized that a player in 1995 by the name of Rick Morales had tied the scoring record that Mr. Mackey created in 1933.
Uh-huh.
And he called Mr. Mackey to tell him about this and ask him his reaction to the fact that it would probably be broken on Thanksgiving Day. And Mr. Mackey said, what record? He held the record for 62 years, never knew it for a moment.
Really?
Nope. And he said to the reporter, he says, I hope he breaks it. I hope he enjoys it for longer than I did. And great guy. They were so humble, him and Ronnie Cahill both. Bill Mackey, I asked him, do you watch football, Mr. Mackey? He says, yeah. I said, what's different about the sport today? He goes, they celebrate everything. Mm-hmm. What do you mean? He says, they celebrate everything from touchdowns to blocks to tackles to sacks.
They do that.
Yeah. And he said, no. I said, why not? He goes, I was too busy picking up the other 10 guys that helped me score that touchdown. So a different thought process, so to speak.
Especially, now we have the TV coverage today.
Yeah, right.
So everything's...
Yeah, it's a different age. And of course, 1933 was the depth of the Depression. And football was like an elixir to people locally and throughout the nation. There were some tough times, and people were awfully proud of their football team here locally.
Mm-hmm.
Fitchburg did some...
Well, we were really good.
Yeah, they did some miraculous things. And... I'm really proud that this summer that Bill Belichick read that book and sent me a nice letter.
How did he find it?
I sent it to him about probably back in 10.
And you wrote it in 2010?
When I wrote it, yeah, and he got around to reading it. He sent me a letter. One Saturday I went to my office to get the mail, and there was a letter from Bill Belichick.
Hey.
And he talked to thanked me for it, and they said it brought him back to remembrances of his dad who played in that era. And he enjoyed the language and the way the story was captured. So I said, well, I can't get a better testimonial as a football historian than Bill Belichick.
No, you can't.
No.
He's the best.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I'd agree.
He spoke at my college graduation.
Oh, did you go to Wellesley?
No. New England Institute of Technology in Rhode Island.
Oh, interesting.
Yep. He told quite the story. He was comparing the story of college life to a football team. And
yeah.
It was a little dry, but I was very interested.
Yeah, yeah. What year was that?
2003.
2001, something around
he's
that.
He's getting his traction as a coach at that point.
Mm-hmm.
That's great. Yeah, so Rivals is a compendium of, it has all the box scores from every year in the series, from 1894 to 2015.
So you went back and scoured the historical records of
every
football.
Every newspaper account of every game.
Uh-huh.
It talks about the weather, some unique things about that particular game, who some of the stars were, the size of the crowd. There's over 100 photographs, interspersed throughout the book. And there's statistics for the whole series from...
Now, did you compile these statistics from all the data?
I had some help. I had a freelance writer named Mike Richard from Gardner that helped with it.
Mm-hmm.
I went back.
Because I'm sure it wasn't compiled back then.
This was painstaking work,
yeah.
Piece by piece. And then there's about 20,000 words of text at the front end of the book that talks about how the series got started. I was able to uncover a game before the 1894 game. It was always thought that the first game in the series occurred on October 20th, 1894, at the Trotting Park in Leominster, which is essentially the upper portion of Doyle Field.
Okay.
But I found a game played in 1893 between the juniors of Leominster High School and the freshman team of Fitchburg.
Really?
Yeah.
Who won?
Fitchburg.
Go figure.
Yeah, Fitchburg was quite a place back then.
Yeah.
Leominster was much smaller, and there was a period of time that Leominster just wasn't really too competitive with Fitchburg, with the exception of a few years when Lou Little played in 1910, 1911, that era. But there was a time, I think, between 1913 and 1924 that I think Leominster scored one touchdown against Fitchburg.
Ouch.
In 13 games.
Ouch.
Losing all of those games but tying one in 1921.
The pendulum swings.
It does.
Right?
It's a remarkable. When that book came out in 2010, the series was dead tied, 58 and 10.
Historically,
yeah.
You mean?
Yeah, it was tied.
Uh-huh.
I mean, it was crazy because it became tied when I convinced the Sentinel that a Fitchburg victory that was carried for all of the years between 1898 and 2010 was actually a 0-0 tie. And they changed the schedule on the paper.
Mm-hmm.
And when they did that, the series became tied 58-58-10. And in the 2010 game at Doyle Field, the game ended in a tie. And then they played an overtime,
yeah.
And it ended in a overtime tie. They had to play a second overtime tiebreaker to finally break the tie.
And who won?
Leominster.
Aha! Wow, after double overtime.
Yeah, crazy. Like, you can't make that up.
So, this is, the Rivals is the sequel, if you will, to A Game That Forged Rivals.
Which is my very first book.
Which is the first book. And when was that written?
2009.
2009.
Quite by accident.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I drive by a beautiful pasture in Doyle on the Doyle Estate,
mm-hmm.
on Lindell Avenue in Leominster, mostly daily because it's on my way to the gym.
Mm-hmm.
And I looked at that pasture several times and came up with an idea of recreating an antique football game there. And I called the trustees of reservations that maintain the land and asked them whether we could do it. And I thought they were going to tell me I was crazy. And they went along with it. And we recreated the first 1894 Leominster Fitchburg game on that pasture, sort of a field of dreams, if you will.
Yeah.
And I started writing a program because football was so very different back then. So people would understand what they were watching. For example, there was no forward pass. It wasn't four downs to make 10 yards. It was three downs to make five. And if you didn't make the 5 yards, you could keep the ball if you backed up 20.
Really?
Yeah, totally different.
Interesting.
Rules. And I found so much, and I wanted to preserve it and share it with people, that it turned into a book that I thought would sell 100 copies to my family and friends. And
but everyone loves it.
It's still selling.
Yeah.
It's actually still, my publisher has a section of the Barnes & Noble website, and as of today, it was number 3 on that list.
Nice.
So it's still
going.
It's still selling. After.
And now that you can get the Rivals,
you can put them all together, the whole trilogy.
So was that the first book that you ever wrote?
Yeah. Well, I wrote a few plays. I lived near an 18th century tavern And I've written some plays about that tavern.
Is that Kendall Tavern. Kendall Tavern.
And the first play I wrote was about recreating the election of 1800 from the perspective of a local tavern.
Uh-huh. And this play was meant to be acted.
Yeah, we did it at the tavern, in the barn at the tavern. Just a complete lark. It was a farce, really. A lot of fun. But it was, you know, just something to do. And I wrote those, but the first real book I wrote was A Game That Forged Rivals.
And that got you really into a lot of sports.
Yeah, and you know, my second book, as I said, was 1933, and then I ended up with an opportunity to write JoJo White's story, and that was the third book in 2012. And Tommy Heinsohn told me that my book got JoJo White in the Hall of Fame. I don't know if that's true, but coming from Tommy Heinsohn, I'll take that as a big compliment. Mm. My fourth book was the book that I've always wanted to write, which was a book about a Leominster abolitionist named Frances Drake, which came out in 2014, a very courageous lady that fought not only to free slaves, but for women's rights at a time when giving women the vote or rights was more radical than freeing slaves.
Mm-hmm.
And then my fifth book, fifth, sixth, and seventh came pretty close together. The fifth book was a book called Leominster Chronicles, which has 42 historical sketches of Leominster history with 80 photographs. Book six was a book called 10 Times the Champion, the story of the Celtic legend Sam Jones, which was another authorized biography. And it's not all every day you get to write a book about a 10-time NBA champion.
Yeah.
Him and Bill Russell, the winningest duo in American sports. Nobody has
still.
Yeah, no one will be. No. No one has won more championships than Sam Jones, except for Bill Russell, who was with the Celtics 1 year before him and won 11.
When they won like 10 years in a row,
they won 11 years out of 13.
11 out of 13.
Eight in a row at one point. Sam was on a team for all those 8 wins. They lost in 67 and came back and won in 68 and 69. He retired in 69, and then Rivals was the seventh book.
Nice. What's next?
I'm working on a book about a senator, a state senator from New Hampshire, who is a little bit of a cross between a state senator in New Hampshire, is like being a ward counselor here, but he's also...
they get paid very little.
$200 a term.
Yeah.
He's also a Washington power broker, because if you run for president, you need to win the New Hampshire primary, right? Very important.
Okay, yes.
And if you're a Democrat and you want to win the New Hampshire primary, his district is very important, because he's the key Democratic senator in New Hampshire. So as early as 2003, there was a Washington Post article written about him that, you know, pointed out that he's a Washington power broker. You want to become president, you're a Democrat, you need to go see Lou D'Alessandro.
Is that what inspired you to write it?
Yeah, he sought me out because he's friends with all these former Celtic legends.
Uh-huh.
I thought he was coming. He came to the Boston Garden last fall. I thought he was coming just to say hello to Sam Jones.
He wanted you to write his biography.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
So, yeah, so he's a tremendous guy.
Is he a crude senator or
yeah,
past?
He's the dean of the New Hampshire Senate.
He's the longest serving senator.
In New Hampshire, correct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I know that from the dean of deans in Leominster.
Yeah, there you go.
The longest serving mayor.
Yeah.
So I get that.
Well, he's a little bit behind Dean Mazzarelli. He's only been in for 20 years.
Just a little.
Yeah, a little bit. But he's a fascinating guy.
And when is this book coming out?
The end of the year.
Uh-huh. And do we get to know his name?
Yeah, his name is Lou D'Alessandro.
Lou D'Alessandro.
Yeah.
Mm. State senator out of New
Hampshire. He's a guy from East Boston. He played football at UNH. He ended up, migrating up to New Hampshire. And he's a great college football player and quite an athlete in his younger years. And he got into politics. And he's got a great anecdote. He told me that when he was in college, Kennedy was running for president, and he wanted to see Kennedy pretty badly, and they closed the assembly hall down because the place was overcrowded, and he made a pact that he was going to get in there one way or another, and he started casing the building, and he found a window, and he squeezed through the window.
He climbed through the window.
Yeah, couldn't do that today, right, with the Secret Service crawling all over the place. Climbed through the window thinking he was going to fall down to the floor, but he was in a stairwell. So he ended up falling into the stairwell, and this man reached out his hand to help him up and said, "Hello, I'm John Kennedy."
Oh.
And he said, "Hello, I'm Lou D'Alessandro."
What a good story. This sounds really interesting.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, it should
so,
be fun.
So Lou D'Alessandro, that's coming up. That'll be the ninth book?
That'll be the eighth book.
The eighth book by Mark Bodanza.
And I'm working on a children's book.
Oh,
I met an illustrator who, a young illustrator, wanted to work with me, and we're doing a...
Where can we find more information?
MarkBodanza.com.
MarkBodanza.com. Find out more information.
Get my books there. Get them personalized there.
Great.
Amazon, all the usual places, Barnes & Noble.